So I grew up in a small village in the Spanish Pyrenees with cold and fast-flowing waters. I was, as Astrid told you, I was all the time going to the rivers to collect invertebrates, but also to fly fishing. But then I moved to Barcelona to do my studies, and my supervisor asked me if I wanted to do the PhD in ecology. And I said, of course, yes, I wanted to know more about the rivers. But he told me, okay, then why if you study Mediterranean intermittent rivers? And I said, what? What do you mean? Rivers that dry up in summer and have no droughts to go and catch them? And then, I hesitate a bit, but I said, okay, then let's go for it. So I moved to the Mediterranean, and I discovered a very nice and exciting world there. Very nice food, very nice wine, very beautiful landscapes, and a wonderful atmosphere. I imagine that most of you have visited one or several Mediterranean areas in the world and understand very well what I am talking about. So this Mediterranean climate, or these Mediterranean regions, are not unique of the Mediterranean basin, but are present in other different areas in the world. So we have Mediterranean climates in California, we have Mediterranean climate in central Chile, in the Cape area of South Africa, in southwestern Australia, and also in South Australia. All these areas share common precipitation patterns with cold and wet winter periods and hot and warm and dry summer periods, with a precipitation that ranges between 400 and 900 millimeters per year. Rivers in these areas are considered unique ecosystems and were actually considered as such in a seminal paper published in 1999 by Avital Gazit and Vince Resch, and updated in a special issue we edited for Hydrobiologia in 2013 that included 21 review papers and more than 40 international researchers coming from Mediterranean, but also from non-Mediterranean regions of the world. Working in this kind of rivers, in these Mediterranean rivers, implies to have to deal with several challenges and opportunities in both in research and also in management. And this is what I would like to show you today and what this is the result of several years of a study of our research group. The first challenge is that Mediterranean rivers have a high spatial and temporal variability, which provides a lot of complexity. So in all Mediterranean areas of the world, we can see that there are different landscapes, morphologies. We have areas such as California, Chile, and also some areas in the Mediterranean basin that have high mountains, for example, no? the Sierra Nevada, the Andes, or the Sierra Nevada also in Spain. And also, there are different other kinds of landscapes, such as plateau or coastal mountains, that provide a high variability of rivers. For example, on the left, this is not working, I think. Maybe you cannot see it. On the left, you can see a typical Mediterranean river of the Cape area, which is very acidic with pHs of 4, 5, and very oligotrophic and full of humic substances. In the center, you can see a karstic river from a typical Mediterranean basin river. And on the right, you can see the Biobío river, a very famous river in central Chile that drains from the Andes, and as you can see, have very high flows and velocities. But what is also very typical from the Mediterranean rivers is their temporal variability. So after the rains in the beginning of October, rivers start to change what we call the different aquatic states. So they start from an hyperreic state, where all the habitats, the macrohabitats in the river, are completely connected by riffles. After this flood, we come back to the euraic state, so what we know as a typical river with riffles connected by pools. But as we approach the spring, as we approach the summer, these riffles start to disappear, and the systems shift to what we call the oligoreic state, so that pools are connected by riffles. Eventually, these pools can become isolated, so the riffles dry up completely, and the river is completely transformed in a sequences of isolated pools that function very differently from a connected river. These pools can eventually dry up, but the river can still maintain subsurface flow. And sometimes these conditions totally dry up, and we can find what we call an adaphic environment. No, the rivers completely dry in surface and subsurface. This implies that Mediterranean rivers have a shifting wet and dry conditions. So intermittent rivers, rivers that are dry up at some point in summer, are common. Of course, not all dry up in summer, but the frequency is very high. In natural rivers, but also in highly human-impacted rivers, such as this one, which is a typical rambla from a village in the north of Barcelona. Of course, Clement talked the other day that intermittent rivers now is such an issue for researchers, and of course, intermittent rivers are not only present in the Mediterranean regions. They are present worldwide, as you can see here in the photos taken from different countries. And actually, the global estimation suggests that more than 50% of the river network worldwide is intermittent. And this is especially true if we consider all the headwaters of the rivers worldwide. Also, future expectations of intermittent rivers are increasing. So in many regions of the world, such as the ones you can see here in red and orange, the models indicate that intermittent rivers will increase its frequency. So given that, why Mediterranean rivers are so unique? If intermittent rivers are present worldwide, why we always say that Mediterranean climate ecosystems have rivers that are unique? The answer is that Mediterranean rivers and this kind of intermittent rivers are very seasonal and predictable. And what is more important here is that Mediterranean rivers have a high predictability. Drying always occurs in summer, more or less intensity, longer days or drying or less, but the predictability of drying events is very high. And actually, when we analyze this, considering precipitation patterns and comparing the degree of predictability and the degree of seasonality of different regions of the world, the ones that have higher predictability and higher seasonality are California, Chile, Spain, Western Australia. The others, such as New Zealand, Arizona, and other regions of the world, have other different precipitation patterns. So predictability of drying events is an important thing. The second challenge I would like to point you out today is that Mediterranean rivers also have a high biodiversity values. Probably you know this map from a Nature paper published in 2000, where the authors indicate what are the hotspots of biodiversity worldwide. As you can see here, all Mediterranean regions, highlighted in green, are included. But these estimations only consider terrestrial fauna, terrestrial plants, and terrestrial vertebrates, and were based on species endemisms and threat. So we didn't know if freshwater biodiversity in Mediterranean rivers were also high, or compared to terrestrial plants and vertebrates, or not. So could we consider also Mediterranean rivers worldwide as a hotspot for freshwater biodiversity? I would say that yes, so and several evidences support this. For example, if we compare the macroinvertebrates communities and the macroinvertebrate diversity in Europe, in the Mediterranean area, here on the top, and in the temperate area of Europe, the Mediterranean area has much more number of genera, and much a higher number of exclusive genera, genera that are only found in the Mediterranean area. And also, there is a gradient of gamma diversity as we move from the south of and north of Africa and south of Spain to the north of Europe. Besides this, if we look at the levels of endemism of each Mediterranean region in the world, we also can say that the freshwater biodiversity in these areas are very high. You can see here in California, 60% of the species, of the fish species, are endemic. In the Mediterranean basin, the same, 63%. But if we move to the southern hemisphere, Mediterranean regions, you can see here 80% of the aquatic plant species in Chile are endemic from the Mediterranean region. 92% of the Plecopteran species in the Cape area are endemic from the Mediterranean region. 86% of the aquatic plants, 71% of the Trichoptera species. These are very high levels of endemisms that suggest that these Mediterranean regions could be considered also hotspot for freshwater biodiversity. Of course, this biodiversity is very different among the different Mediterranean regions. And for example, Mediterranean Basin, California, and also the South Australia have higher levels of macroinvertebrate richness in comparison with other regions, other Mediterranean regions, which has been associated to several historical but also ecological factors. The reason behind all this high level of biodiversity in these Mediterranean regions are twofold. On one side, there are the historical processes. So most of these areas are located in regions that have been subjected to high tectonic activity, such as all the different islands and different movement between plates in the Mediterranean basin. But also, in this particular case of the Mediterranean basin, the different African connections during the Messinian crisis also were important as a pool of species, and also the effects, of course, of the glaciations in these areas. This has resulted, for example, that in the Mediterranean basin, we have several archaic species, very old species, such as several Unio, the mollusks, inhabiting there, but also we have several pre-glacial relics of such as several mollusks also that are unique from this area. We also have riparian species of species that are found in different islands in the Mediterranean and in mainland. Post-Messinian colonization species such as this fish that you can see here, and also glacial relics that are also found there. But together with these historical factors, another important factor that has resulted in this high biodiversity is this predictable seasonality. So the Mediterranean climate is about 3-4 million years old, and this predictable seasonality has allowed the species to evolve and to diversify in many different species. Actually, this seasonality implies that in comparison with, for example, macroinvertebrate communities in Arizona, but especially in more oceanic climates such as New Zealand, macroinvertebrates shift completely from the wet period to the dry period. So we have some species that are typically found during the wet period, what we call the flowing phase. So the river is connected, many species are adapted to these flowing conditions. But in the dry period, we have typically a high diversity of what we call the pool phase. So a species adapted to these lengthy conditions, these isolated pools. And as a whole, this result also in a high beta diversity, temporal beta diversity, dominated by turnover. So the communities shift strongly from the wet period to the dry period. All this seasonality also has resulted in many adaptations of the organisms of plants, such as this one, which is the Nerium oleander, a typical riparian plant in some rivers in the Mediterranean basin, but also some species of Trichoptera that are adapted, that have life cycles more or less synchronized with these drying events, and adaptations or behaviors as adults that has been acquired through evolution thanks to all this regularity or predictability of these drying events. And actually, when we look at this of the functional diversity, the diversity of traits that Mediterranean rivers have in terms of macroinvertebrates, in comparison with the rivers found in more temperate areas, we can see that in the Mediterranean, as you can see here on the top right, the functional space is much more wider. So that there are more species with more variety of traits, and this, of course, implies a higher functional diversity. These biodiversity patterns, or the communities of organisms inhabiting there, are also very special. In terms of overall, the results, or we have found that if we compare permanent rivers, perennial rivers, rivers that never dry up in summer, with intermittent rivers worldwide, we have found that perennial rivers are always much, or have a higher diversity than intermittent rivers. But when we look at the Mediterranean, and in particular in all the regions in the Mediterranean, and we do the same, we compare the richness levels of perennial rivers and intermittent rivers, we found that there were no differences. So this also implies that Mediterranean rivers, in terms of community composition, is very unique. Because in flow intermittency, in contrast to what happens in the other intermittent rivers of the world, doesn't imply a reduction or a significant reduction of freshwater diversity. One interesting point that in terms of management has will have, I think, in the future, a strong implications is that nowadays, biological communities are not only explained by what we call the species sorting, the niche filtering, are also explained by a combination of the niche filtering and dispersal. So maybe you can have a very good river, a very good habitat that you could live there, but if you cannot get there because of you or because there are some barriers, then you will not be fine there. So this brings me to what now is very popular in community ecology, which is meta-communities. So local communities are not only explained by environmental factors, but also by the dispersal abilities of species or landscape constraints, such as, for example, mountain barriers that isolate different communities, or different events that also indeed favor the dispersal of organisms, such as the floods or wind that can move adults from one side to another. When we look at the people that has been working on river ecosystems in analyzing these meta-community patterns, there is a very well-established model, meta-community model, that imply that, or that just suggest that headwater communities are mainly explained by niche filtering, by the species sorting, so local environmental conditions, but because of the flow and because of this network, typical network of river catchments, downstream reaches are mainly explained by dispersal of individuals that arrive there, and the environmental conditions start to filter, but there is more arrival of individuals than filtering. But what happens when the river in the middle of this catchment dry up? So this is one of the challenges we have when we try to apply these meta-community models in Mediterranean rivers. So suddenly, the river disappears. There is no this flow connecting headwaters, downstream areas, no flow of organisms. So what happens? And this can last, as I said before, for several days, weeks, or months. So do these meta-community models apply here? Of course, this is increasing complexity, and of course, depending on in which aquatic state we are in the moment, the factors that will explain local community composition, either niche filtering or dispersal, of course, will change in time, depending if we are with isolated pools or if we are during the regwetting events. And so, this classical static model of meta-communities doesn't apply when you go to this kind of intermittent rivers. And dispersal and species sorting just shift depending if you are in the regwetting, if you are in the normal conditions, or if you are in the drying events. I will switch this. So the third challenge I would like to point out here today is that these regions that have a high levels of biodiversity, unique biodiversity, are considered hotspots, are complex, are, from a research and fundamental point of view, are very interesting, also have a high human population density. Actually, I don't know, but I don't think that nowhere else in the world we can have rivers ecosystems subjected to such a kind of variety and intensity of human impacts, and for such long. So in the, for example, these are photos. Marta will know very well these are photos from Spain. So we have been having water diversions and also dams from the Roman Empire, from the Roman times. So rivers in these areas have been heavily modified since very, very long, since long time ago. And also, because of this high density of population, they are subjected to a very wide variety of human pressures. So you can see here organic pollution. So in many regions of the Mediterranean, Morocco, Algeria, Turkey, so many rivers are like this, which are open, are sewage water on dry riverbeds. River channels have been heavily modified. This is near Malaga. Also, some people think that rivers are just roads to park the cars until the next flood will come, so they are always disasters. And also golf courses, landscape modifications, habitat degradation in general. Also, we have a strong problem with salinity. These rivers that modify the discharge so strongly along the year. So salinity affects natural, but also non-natural, coming from mining. It's very important. Of course, invasive species are also an issue, as everywhere. Fire. Fire is such a characteristic of Mediterranean climates, but of course, it has strong implications and strong effects on river ecosystems. And of course, new emerging pollutants that are a hot topic now, and we are witnessing changes in behavior and also in physiological aspects in the organisms. So this high biodiversity, this complexity of rivers, these rivers that are heavily modified. Also, we should add that there is a poor recognition in the society for their environmental values. And all this makes that working in these areas and managing these rivers is quite complex. So you, this is the same picture I showed you before, so I don't know if you can see here because of the light, but these guys here were cleaning a teapot. This is in Morocco, a teapot with this sewage water. So nobody cares. So, or this one. Do you know where is this photo is from? Have you ever been in Barcelona? The Rambla. The Rambla of Barcelona, believe it or not, is a river. And I always make the joke that it's the river that provides more ecosystem services of the world, because it's a touristic, instead of organisms going up and down, there are tourists spending lots of money up and down in the shops or having coffee or whatever. So the Rambla, the name Rambla, is a name for an intermittent, ephemeral river in Catalonia and in all the east part of Spain. So you can see, so rivers have been highly modified. This flood. So you can see all the trash going down. There is a fridge also. Here, the fridge. So this is what I meant, when there is a poor recognition of the environmental values. It's, I don't know how to, okay, of the environmental values of these rivers. They are considered well, like road passes. They are, everybody puts trashes on that. So working in such a systems with, that have a high biodiversity values, it's complicated and complex. So in the last years, we have witnessed actually a change in the mentality of at least the politicians, some of the politicians, and also the managers. We have shifted to what we call the all water culture to what we call the new water culture. These old water cultures were, for example, large public hydraulic infrastructures were built in all Mediterranean regions worldwide to a more integrated management with more transparency, public participation, and where conservation and restoration of river ecosystems were the main focus of our policies. Actually, what we call the shift between the hydraulic era to this integration era has not been equal in all Mediterranean regions of the world. So we have, for example, in California, they started during the 70s with the Clean Water Act. In Spain, we were supposed to be started during the 90s with the publication of the Water Framework Directive, but they are still, and depends on the politicians, the parties, there are still some crazy ideas of transferring water, building dams, so we are not completely integrated in this integration era. And in Chile, the things are even worse. The colleagues that are from Chile here can provide more details about this. Of course, in Europe, and all the Mediterranean regions in Europe, the publication of the Water Framework Directive really means something. So with the objective that the member states, I guess most of you know, no, need to get the good ecological status of the European water bodies, focusing on key elements that have ecologically based and that include ecosystem and integrated management, but also economic rationality and public participation, which is a very important thing. All this should be done using different metrics. So the evaluation of the ecological status should be done considering biological, hydromorphological, and physico-chemical metrics. And the question now is that what happens when the river is intermittent? So actually, the Water Framework Directive and the policies, they don't talk about intermittent rivers. And of course, they should be talk about intermittent rivers, especially because they will increase their frequency. Not only in the Mediterranean, but also here in Central Europe, in Northern Europe. It's a thing that we should worry about in the close future. So before asking what methods we should apply to get an idea of the ecological status of these rivers, we should also consider what is the hydrological status. So, okay, rivers dry up in summer in the Mediterranean, but these drying events are natural or are human-driven drying events? And we have both. So we have rivers that are actually drying, and they shouldn't be drying, because we also have perennial rivers, such as this one. This is the Matarraña. And we also have rivers that should be drying, but they are perennial, because they receive effluents from water treatment plants. So, of course, before going to analyzing the ecological status, first we need to know if they are hydrological impacted or not. And how we do that? Talking with hydrologists, they always say that they don't want to work in intermittent rivers because they are very complex. In addition, we have the isolated pools. And this, there is no information on this coming from gauging stations, for example, as far as I know. So for that, we develop a software that you can download it that combines hydrographs, so information coming from gauging stations, and usually these intermittent rivers, usually they don't have gauging stations, as you can imagine. They are very small. But it also includes information from aerial photographs and also includes information from interviews from the current ages. And then it compares with the hydrological patterns with model simulated flow series. And with this, we can have an idea if the river should be, is naturally intermittent or not. Once we have this, the other question is, okay, if the river is intermittent naturally, do the current methods we have to assess the ecological status of the rivers apply or not? Because drying events is a natural disturbance. And of course, that I said that the intermittent rivers in Mediterranean rivers are highly diverse. But this doesn't mean that there are some species that, of course, are lost, especially if the rivers, the drying duration is important. Could we provide to managers other methods, alternative methods to the existing ones, to have a better idea of the ecological or the biological status of these rivers? So, of course, we know that if the river is very ephemeral, as you can see here compared with the river that maintains pools or is perennial, the biological indexes, the BMWP adapted to Spain, is lower. The number of macroinvertebrates is also lower. So usually these methods, these common metrics, doesn't apply to intermittent rivers. And we need to look for other type of metrics to assess these rivers that are very frequent in the Mediterranean regions, but that will also be very common in other regions in the world. So we need to develop metrics that that respond to human impacts equally, such as in perennial rivers, or that respond more or less similar so that some calibration could be possible. But we cannot use metrics that, for example, that present this kind of patterns, antagonistic or synergistic effects. So this is a challenge for scientists to look for this kind of metrics and to provide tools that are easy, of course, to be applied in, to managers. So we tested this for the typical indices that we use in Spain, and none of the most common indices work in intermittent rivers. But what we found, interestingly, is that functional metrics, metrics based on species traits, and species traits are directly related to environmental conditions, do work. So this is, this opens us, and also to the managers, a new opportunity to develop new metrics. And it's also important to test it in the isolated pool. So imagine each pool works as an island. So it depends if there is a predator, if there is a high primary productivity or less. The pool will have very different community composition, and the common metrics don't apply. And managers ask us to develop this kind of metrics to assess the ecological status as the Water Framework Directive requires. Another aspect that there is also a challenge for researchers is to apply all these meta-community ideas that I was mentioned before. So rivers, some of these intermittent rivers are highly isolated, and maybe when the flow is restored, they would be able to host a high diversity of organisms, but maybe because of this high spatial isolation, they cannot reach there. So this is another challenge to be considered, to integrate this kind of dispersal abilities of organisms, landscape constraints on dispersal into these biological indexes. And actually, we are working on this with people in Lyon right now. And last topic is that Astrid also mentioned is conservation. We all know, and Clement pointed it very well, that freshwater biodiversity is very high in comparison to the surface freshwater occupies in the earth, and they are highly threatened. Many species have become extinct. Many species still we don't know. We are still discovering new species of aquatic insects, and many of them will shift from being unknown to disappear in front of our eyes. This is especially relevant for the fish and this kind of rivers. Many species of fish in the Mediterranean basin are threatened. And this is especially important in this kind of intermittent rivers when we have this habitat reduction with drying, with bottleneck periods, which results in changes in genetic, but also in a species biodiversity. Of course, many species has been recognized, not all has been evaluated, but many species have been recognized to be under threat, critically in danger of different kind of groups. And the existing European network, the European Natura 2000, doesn't mean too much to freshwater biodiversity. So actually, Spain, 25% of the surface of Spain is under this, under the European Natura 2000. but it fails in protecting some fish species, or for example, 70% of the distribution of the Aphanius iverus, one of our standard fish species in Spain, is only protected by this Natura 2000. So this, of course, is a problem, so we need to develop new conservation figures for this kind of systems, but we also need to know what do we want to protect. Do we want to protect endangered species? Do we want to protect river geomorphology? What do we want? Or good habitat quality? What do we want to protect? In this case, for example, in Spain, we have a new figure, which is called Natural Fluvial Reserves, has been designed to protect freshwater rivers. But it failed to protect freshwater biodiversity, too, because it was designed to protect areas which are very beautiful and areas that have good or very good ecological status. And actually, we made a trial in one of our river basins, the Ebro river basins, and we combined scientific work with the participation processes, and we asked several stakeholders to list and prioritize the criteria. What should be protected? What should be these protection areas include? High biodiversity, a wide variety of river types or river forms, good riparian connectivity, loss, no invasive species. And we asked all these people, all these stakeholders in several participation processes to list the criteria, prioritize of what would be the most important criteria to be included in conservation. And as you can see here, the first ones, good biodiversity, good conservation status, and so on. And once we had this, we went to collect the data, and we apply a systematic planning tool, which is called Martian. And what we realized is that 71% of the streams that Martian selected were not protected at all by this European Natura 2000 or this Spanish fluvial reserves. Some species that are considered vulnerable or endangered of macroinvertebrates and fish were not protected by any of the two. So we need to develop new conservation figures, but based on this scientific knowledge. And we also need to imply the citizens. The citizens have a great power to provide information to the scientists, information to the managers. And in this regard, we developed this application that you can download. It's also in English. And it's an application coming from a CTC science project that allows you to assess in a very easy way the ecological status of your river. And actually, you can see, so the citizens send us the information, we validate it, and we can have this information available. So these are the main challenges of we consider that Mediterranean River phase, but of course there are opportunities. So this triangle, researchers, managers, and citizens. We need to believe strongly in this triangle. We need to provide as researchers tools and metrics, including all this scientific knowledge, to managers. We need also to do outreach activities to get all this research information to the citizens, ask the citizens, involve the citizens in these participatory processes. And we also need the citizens also need to contribute to science, also need to contribute to managers, no? Provide them, for example, this kind of information to managers of the local ecological status. If we want to keep these Mediterranean rivers healthy, if we want to maintain their high biodiversity values, even their complexity, we need to believe in this triangle. We need to create these links between researchers, managers, and citizens for the future of our generations. And this is my son starting working in intermittent rivers in the south of Spain. Thank you very much for your attention.